Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome you to worship at Greenwood Memorial United Methodist Church. I am the pastor, Reverend Dr. Imani Sheila Newsom Kamara. We are here ready to worship and praise God. Our liturgist today is Mr. Katiji Kamara, my beloved. We now begin our worship service. Please pray with us. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Through the storm, clouds of doubt and fear threaten to overcome us. God lead us into ways of peace. When the darkness of war and the deep pit of anger reach toward us, God lifts and carries us through the darkness with hope and light. Lord of hope and life, be with us today. God of mercy and peace, lead our lives. People of God, respond by saying, Amen. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 448. We will not be singing. Brother Stanley will be playing. Today. We praise you for delivering our people of old from enslavement in Egypt by opening up a new and unexpected future before them. They experienced your grace and mercy in awesome and life-sustaining ways, which must have been like an impossible dream coming true. Through these acts, you showed your compassion for the weak and powerless of this world. We praise and adore you for opening up a new future for us when your love and compassion, your mercy and grace became enfreshed in Jesus Christ. He delivered us from the bondage of evil and sin through his death on the cross. The impossible once more become a reality. When love defeated evil once and for all, we pray that this time of worship will be a true offering of our wonder and praise that you should share for us so deeply and so faithfully. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The Greenwood Memorial United Methodist Church family welcomes all of you who are present today and who join us by Facebook Live, YouTube, and conference call. We pray that you will experience the love of God as we worship together. As Christians, we do not claim to be perfect people, but we believe we can grow and change through Jesus, through God's guidance, the teaching of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and the rule of the Holy Cross, Holy Ghost. Jesus sent his disciples to greet and bless others by saying, "Peace to this house." Today, we greet and bless each other, offering a non-physical greeting. We greet each of you, by saying, "The peace of Christ be with you," and our response is, "Also with you." Amen. Peace of Christ be with you. Amen.
Together, even though we are spread far apart. We would like to thank God for all of you. Wherever you are, we are one. In terms of announcements, we would like for people to continue to call the church office for reporting those who are ill or sick or shut in. We continue to encourage the congregation to use our WhatsApp announcement pages for congregational care, general announcements, and notes. Please continue to check our Facebook page for the announcements of Greenwood events, such as our prayer meeting on Wednesday night. Other announcements will be presented at appropriate times. Now, as the people of God, we must go to God celebrating the blessings that God has offered us, and we can go to God with all the things that concern us. Let us assume a posture of prayer. At this point, we are going to pray together. We are going to pray together. Please get your hearts ready to pray. The Lord's Prayer will then be offered by the liturgists. We want to pray this morning for the world. We want to pray this morning for the nation. We want to pray for our communities. We want to pray for those in need. We want to pray for families and friends and loved ones. And of course, we'll pray for God's church. So please join me in prayer. Almighty and precious God, we come to you this morning, believing, God, that you sit high and you look low. We come this morning, God, believing that as we cry out to you, you hear us. Because we are your adopted children through Jesus Christ, your Son. And God, we come thanking you this morning for the presence of your Holy Ghost in your house and among your people. God, this morning we come praying for our world. Our world, God, continues to be in turmoil. There is trouble in nations. There is hunger. There is abuse. There is war. There's economic deprivation in the world. And people believe that there is no hope. God, we put our hope in you. And God, we ask you to go into the world, Lord, around the world, and touch those who feel hopeless this morning. For you, God, by your Spirit, can go to places where we cannot go. Almighty and precious God, we come praying for our nation this morning. One part of our nation is on fire, and the other part of our nation is dealing with floods. In some places we are too hot, some places we are too cold. God, in the name of Jesus, some of us are fighting, some of us are spilling out hatred, some of us are trying to spill out love. God, help this nation. God, remember this morning your daughter, Ruth Ginsburg. May her name always be blessed and remembered. God, we ask you to stand with her family as they grieve her loss, and stand with us as we grieve her presence as a champion of justice. God, we come this morning praying for every hall of government, every place where people have a vote and are able to affect the lives of people in communities. God, give guidance. Inspire, God, for people to walk the straight and narrow road and not go off willy-nilly into creating things, God, that cause people pain and agony and humiliation. Oh God, touch your people from sea to the shining sea. Almighty God, we come praying this morning for the state of Massachusetts and for the cities that we inhabit in this state. God, have mercy on us. We believe, God, that you shall overshadow this place and our legislators if we ask, and we do ask this morning. God, we come praying now for your church. Wherever your church is, God, we come praying in unity through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we pray that you shall strengthen your church as we face these chaotic times.
Yes.
Some buildings are locked and empty, but the church still rises.
Yes.
God, someone is just listening by radio or phone, doesn't have Zoom, doesn't have Facebook Live, but God, raise up your church.
Yes.
Oh God, have mercy on this church. God, we will Memorial United Methodist Church. We're here, Lord, and we praise you and glorify you, and we need you this morning. We need you to guide us, God, because the maps we have followed have been erased. And our ways of doing things have disappeared. But you said, God, you'd be a light in the darkness, and you would not abandon us. So as your people, we come bringing our concerns and our heartache and our needs and our desires, knowing, God, that you will not forsake us if we appeal to you. So everyone within the sound of my voice, God, we lift up all that's on our heart, and we give you thanks because we believe that you are a prayer answering God. Please, Lord, as your people, we ask you to hear our prayer. Amen.
As a gesture of our unity in prayer, please rise if you are able, and let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated. Thank you, church. We come to this time in our service where we are collecting our tithes and offerings. We have responsibilities at Greenwood, and this community, praise God, has been faithful. And I want to thank you. Thank you, Greenwood, for maintaining your commitment to this church. I know it has not been easy. Things have happened. Some of us have had our pay cut in half. Some of us have lost jobs. Some of us are struggling to put food on the table. Or some of us had to buy a computer for remote learning for our niece or a nephew or a grandchild. But I just want to say, you've been faithful not to me, but to God. And to God be the glory. We continue to do the work of the church. Don't let the closed door fool you. Greenwood is on the move. We are working for the kingdom of God. And so we give thanks today for what God has allowed us to give. And we trust that God will keep us ready to give when the need is there for this house, because we trust God in all things. Let us pray. Almighty and precious God, we have brought our gifts to your house. And God, we have sought to be obedient. You said 10%. Some of us can give 10, some more, some less. But God, we're giving because we love you. And we love your house.
take what we have and expand it like yeast expands dough, and allow your church to be cared for. Thank you, God, for those who give their time and talent and make things happen. They have not bread, they have not asked to praise, but God, you know who the people are. Bless their gifts that they bring to this house. We have been obedient, Lord. In Jesus' name, we give you thanks. Amen. Let us rise for the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. We will not sing, but we will stand to affirm this praise.
The scripture lesson, my southern roots, can be found in the chapter in Exodus in the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 14, verses 19 through 28 and 31. Then the angels of God, who had been traveling in front of Israel's army, withdrew and went behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from in front and stood behind them, coming between the armies of Egypt and Israel. Throughout the night, the cloud brought darkness to the one side and light to the other side, so neither went near the other all night long. When Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with a wall of water on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued them, and all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of fire and cloud at the Egyptians' army and threw it into confusion. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so that they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, "Let us get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the waters may flow back over the Egyptians and their chariots and horsemen." Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at daybreak, the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing toward it, and the Lord swept them into the sea. The waters flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites into the sea, none of them survived. Verse 31, and when the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians. The people heard the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses, his servants. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Let us pray. God, we come now to hear your word. God, illuminate this text. Allow us to hear it, but not just hear it, God. Allow us to tell somebody about this message, about this text. Set in our hearts and minds that we may hear your word. Amen.
Amen.
The title of this sermon is When. When. I know you're like, well, when what? But you'll find out as you go. When? Pharaoh released the Hebrew people from enslavement, and they are forced to behold 6,000 men and countless women and children leave Egypt. God directs them to go by the long road. They travel through Succoth, then to Etham, on the desert's edge. And then they travel between two cliffs to get to the Red Sea. Oh, they're excited about freedom. And then that freedom is threatened. Pharaoh decides to pursue the Hebrews. Slave labor is hard to find. Getting folks to work for below minimum wage is great if Pharaoh does not get the Hebrew people back. The Egyptian economy will be impaired. As the noise of the wheels of the chariot rock the earth, and the military bears down on the Hebrew people, they begin to weep. 600 chariots are coming, and it looks like it's all over. Now, the text says that God was in front of the people, overshadowing them with a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Then the text continues, an angel of the Lord came. This angel is called Malik Elohim. This angel is a messenger, or agent, or warrior of God. And this angel comes to stand behind the Hebrew people. The angel comes to protect the Hebrew people. Malak Elohim. Then there is this cloud that begins to move. This is God's manifestation of God's glory. This cloud leaps with an internal fire, that same fire that appeared on the burning bush. And this light, this fire, gives light to the Hebrew people. And you know it's God because there's fire on they can see. And on the other side of the cloud is a thick, cloaking darkness that surrounds the Egyptian army. The cloud, positioned between the Hebrews and the Egyptians, keeps the Egyptian army from seeing God's people. Let me just say this morning, God will hide you in the time of trouble. I don't know who that's for, but somebody needs to hear that this morning.
Amen, amen.
Realize this, the Hebrews can no longer see the Egyptians who they fear. The cloud moves to remind people to look to God and not to trouble when they're by the Red Sea. Your salvation is in the cloud. Not the cloud that Google puts up or Apple puts up where you put your documents to save them in case your computer crashes. Your salvation is in God. The power of God. The mighty cloud of God's presence. When your back's against the wall, God's got your back.
Amen.
As the Egyptians fall back in the dark, God begins to work for his people. God moves on the most powerful wind noted in the Bible, the east wind. The east wind is the wind of power in the Bible. It pushes the world around. It changes the landscape. It changes people's lives. There are four winds in the Bible, but the east wind is a hot and dry and powerful wind. And that wind begins to move the waters of the Red Sea. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
All through the night, God moves on the wind, and that wind moves water and makes glassy sea walls on each side of the Red Sea. It is through those water walls that God's people walk. Here's the lesson. When, somebody say when. When your back's against the wall, God acts. On your behalf, we do not receive the work of God, yet we believe that God does work in the world, amen? And we believe that God acts on our behalf. We are his people.
Yes, yes.
When our back's against the wall, God acts on our behalf. In the dark of night, God works in the east wind and dries the floor of the Red Sea.
Yes, yes.
The Hebrew people escape from the Egyptians under the stars of night. As the Hebrew people move toward freedom, the cloud and the pillar of fire depart with them. That cloud moves. God leads them. And Pharaoh sees an opportunity. That cloud is gone. That wall of protection is gone. So Pharaoh ordered the Egyptian army down into the Red Sea. The chariots, riders drive to cut down the escaping people. But the Bible says that even though they travel deep into the sea, trying to cross the Red Sea in the dark, they've got a long way to go because God's already got his people on the other side. God will bring you to the other side. You better say, preach, Pastor. God's got people, got his people on the other side. But the Egyptians keep pursuing them. And during the last watch of the night, between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m., the agents of terror, the Egyptian army, keep driving in order to ambush the people of God. But God. Anybody here ever had a but God moment? You would have been hurt, but God. You would have been tripped up, but God. You would have been dead, but God. You would have been broke, but God. There is a but God movement about to happen here. God, who does not slumber or sleep, moves according to his timeline. God tells Moses to stretch out his hand over the sea so that the waters flow over the Egyptians and their chariots and their horses. Between darkness at 3 o'clock in the morning and the dawn at 6 a.m., the Red Sea creeps. And as the army gains on people, God muddies the riverbed and chariot wheels get stuck. As the army gains on the people, fights break out among the ranks. As God moves, as people move, orders are given and people misunderstand what they've heard. As God moves, as the Egyptian moves, currents emerge. Foamy waters make it difficult to see. Rocks break the legs of horses. And the enemies of God begin to shout, "Oh my God, this God is on the side of these people." God will make your enemies shout.
Yes, yes.
That God is on your side.
Amen, amen.
Oh God. And then this silence. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Egyptians into the sea was no longer visible. When your back's against the wall, and your enemy, your haters, your Instagram tormentors, your family members come for you, God has a plan, a counterattack strategy designed to deliver you from evil.
Amen.
When your back's against the wall, God has a strategy of counterattack.
Yes, yes.
When the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in God. When they saw what God had done, they remembered that God had sent advocates, Moses and Aaron. They remembered that God had made Moses the strategic leader to bring them out of bondage. But in the moment of fear, in the moment of the fight, what did they do? They began to quiver based on their understanding of what they could do. They were afraid, thinking there was no hope. Say amen. Let me remind you this morning that just like God reminded the Hebrew people, God can remind us there is no one like our God.
Amen.
We may be startled by the arrival of trouble, but the cloud of the Holy Spirit, the glory of God will hover over us in our enemy's presence. God will put a barrier between us and those who seek to unravel us, those who seek to dissolve our lives, those who seek to dissolve our authority, those who seek to put us down, those who seek to erase us. God will put a barrier.
Yes, yes. Yes, yes.
Between us and the enemy. God will move to keep God's people safe, and God will confuse the enemy. When your back's against the wall, God's got your back.
Amen. Amen.
Church, you need to remember this. God does not wear an Apple Watch. God does not slumber or sleep. We may face midnights or prison wall. And death is in front of us. And sin is bearing down on us to recapture us and make us slaves to sin. God designed a counterattack. You know he did. God designed a counterattack for our deliverance. Jesus left his space in heaven. Jesus came and flesh and divinity merged into one. Very, very God and very, very man. Jesus lived and taught about God's love. Then Jesus demonstrated that love with his counterattack, God's plan, on the cross. Jesus destroyed sin's power in our lives.
Yes.
Y'all too quiet. Let me say it again. On the cross, Jesus destroyed the power of sin in our lives. God's plan. He wasn't expected. Jesus wasn't expected. People said he wasn't who he said he was, but God didn't stop. God still offered a counterattack, and sin was defeated. When the tomb was closed, the world laughed. But God stuck with God's strategy. On the third day, God revealed a path through the sea of death. On the third day, Jesus got up out of the tomb. Angels rolled the stone away, and Jesus walked out with freedom in his hand. And he eliminated the sting of death for all who believe in him. Hallelujah! When God's got your back. Hallelujah! There's a counterattack. All glory. That's why, church, we agree today, no matter where we are, that if we're in a mess, God's got our back, and God will turn our mess into a message. That's why we agree today at the church, when we face trials and troubles, God's got our back, and God will turn our trials into triumph. Yes. Come on, church. We agree today that when we feel like victims, Jesus, when we feel like victims and nobody loves us, God's got our back, and God makes us victors through Christ Jesus.
Somebody ached all night long, but God, we claim
delivered.
Amen.
God, help us to remember this today. And not only remember it, Lord, help us to carry the message outside of our homes, outside of our church, outside of our workspace. Somebody this week is going to feel bad, and you begin the sentence with when. When God has your back.
Amen. Yes, yes.
Deliverance is our king. Help us, God, to be ambassadors of truth. This truth that comes from this text, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody ought to say hallelujah. You've been locked down and locked up. But when God's got your back, oh Jesus. Gonna stop. Ain't gonna be here all day. But I just need to just praise God even if you won't.
Amen.
Because I know God has brought me out. Lord Jesus, we have our closing hymn. Hymn number 127. Guide me, O thy great Jehovah. And this is our closing prayer. Guide us, God. Guide us away, because we know you will when you have our back. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
Through the storm clouds of doubt and fear, God leads us to ways of peace. When the darkness of war threatens to overcome us, God lifts us and carries us through darkness with fire and light. Our God of hope and life is with us. We go from this worship experience, but not from God's presence. God always has our back. We lift this blessing and benediction in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. The people of God respond by saying, amen.
Amen.
Please remain seated for the posture. It is our time to worship and pray before we leave this worship experience. Amen. Thank you.